questions, comments?
I have a question.
Yeah.
Do you think there was an influence of D. Ford Bailey on him playing on the Opry every week?
D. Ford Bailey played for Opry?
Yeah.
I did not know.
Yeah.
I did not know.
You know, played a lot of, not blues exactly, but, you know, novelty songs on harmonica.
I did not know.
Yeah. Because he probably would have heard it on the radio, would have been aware of it, starting in the mid-20s, late-20s.
Yeah, it seems to me that the performing style and vocal style are very, very different.
Yeah.
So, probably, I don't think Sonny Boy was influenced by the Ford Bailey that much.
Yeah. Bailey played blues?
I mean, I just know a couple. Bailey played a little bit of blues, but not so much on the Opry. He was playing, there were novelty songs where he'd imitate trains and stuff like that. You know, Pan American was his best known.
Do you think, did he acquire the crunchy sound before the amplifier?
A very interesting question. I mean, that countryfied sound, he acquired, of course, he started using amp, okay? And then, when he used amp and microphone, and if you still maintain that Sonny Boy's performing style, that's overkill. That's way too much, right? So you really needed to come up with a different performing style for mic and amp. And I don't think Sonny Boy really liked it. I mean, later his recording, he really tried to cut notes, and more like playing a single note, something like, oops. Yeah, something like that. Instead of, right. So when you do this, you know, that type thing with a mic, that's too much. Yeah. It's like heavy metal. So I think Sonny Boy would probably wanted to stay with this, you know, his established performing style mostly. And the amp is probably, I did that for gig, but, you know, not for recording. And the recording producer's name is Lester Merrill's. He recorded a lot of big names then for bluegrass records like Big Bill Brunzi, Tampered, Big Mason and all that. I mean, he kind of refused to use amp. He was just hating the sound. He thought that it was kind of vulgar. And that actually when I did the research, do you remember there's a jazz record mod?
Yeah,
in Chicago, you know, the guy who was
just closed.
Yeah, the guy who was running the store.
I don't know his name.
Anyhow, he is sort of a history of blues, Chicago blues itself. Okay, and he shared me that. When he recorded Big Bill Brunzi, Pinewood Blues or something like that. Big Joe Williams brought this amplifier. What it is? It's an old portable radio that, you know, he tend to be an amplifier. It had a terrible, terrible sound, but now you love it, right? Because we love that kind of sound nowadays. But, you know, guy who ran the store and a record company, you know, Denmark Records, you know, it's just horrible sound. Probably Lester Merrill had the same impression about this amplifier hub, you know, and the low quality microphone.
Can I ask another
question? Yeah, sure, of course.
Who started using the word Delta Blues? Does anybody know?
Delta Blues.
Delta. And I guess this follow up, was there a stigma around country blues in Chicago? Is that why he wasn't listed?
Yeah.
In the obituary, or with a broader obituary in the media, do you think?
Okay, the first question, I don't know who started to call it Delta Blues.
I don't.
No, I don't. I mean, you say Delta blues, country blues, down home blues, you know, that all includes almost all the acoustic blues.
But is Jackson, Tennessee part of the Delta?
I don't think so. Delta blues, when we say Delta blues, we normally refer to Mississippi blues. Yes. And what was the next question?
Oh, I guess I'm wondering if the people in Chicago thought it was rural music or derogatory.
Probably so. I mean, a lot of leaders of Defender were sort of, not to say high class, but well, let's say sophisticated people, probably that's not the right word, but they sort of put down this country blues, or even blues itself, they tend to put it down. It's kind of lower class, working class people's music, as opposed to jazz or sax band or gospel quartet or something like that. So I went through a lot of pages of Defender, and I didn't find a Muddy Waters article until 1953. But until 1948, 1949, 1950, Muddy Waters was a big thing in Chicago, right? Yeah. So I think the general tendency of Defender is almost like a putting the kind of global kind of music. It's surprising to me because probably some of you are familiar with Jeff Titton's book, Book on Blues. We think that the Defender is almost a treasure box of blues research. We find advertisements after, really nicely done advertisements, and the gig announcements, record catalogs and everything. And then if you look at different angles, right, how those blues musicians are treated, you find almost nothing. The interesting thing is that Brian Lemon Jefferson, he is a superstar of country blues, right, with the Black Snake Moan. He died in Chicago, right? You know how he died? You remember?
I don't.
Okay. He's from East Texas, and then he ran up to Chicago. And then he's blind, okay. And one day he went to some kind of a home party, and then he lost his way, and he was close. Yeah, he froze to death. Yeah, yeah. And the Defender didn't cover his obituary. Defender didn't write his obituary. I really tried to look for it, but I couldn't find it. And then someone said, "Well, you're not interested in writing, those country musicians' death." It's really amazing, surprising thing. Yeah. And of course, when this black kid was hit by a white person's car, they make a big deal out of it, right? It's like almost a cover news, right? But this blues musician that he was a kid, probably hit by such and such, at that point, they didn't know the cause of death, but that kind of thing. So it's really amazing to me, especially I'm from a different culture, so it was really mind-boggling.
So they never figured out what happened to him, why he was murdered?